Welcome to the Korea Society and welcome to Studio Korea. I'm Stephen Noerper, the Senior Vice President of the Korea Society. And today we are joined by Ambassador Lee Jung-Hoon. He is newly appointed as Korea's Ambassador for Human Rights, an eminent academic who is with Yonsei University and whose roots are both in Korea and the United States, as he's a graduate of the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. He also went on to Oxford University after and has had an interesting and exciting career, both in academe and as an advisor. President Park Geun-hye named him the Ambassador to Human Rights, and we here at the Korea Society are absolutely delighted to welcome him to New York City, and especially on a day when you have been over at the United Nations. So, Ambassador, welcome. We love the fact that you're here at TKS, and we're hoping that we can talk a bit about North Korean human rights and the human rights interests that are your portfolio.
Well, first of all, thank you for taking the time to invite me, and it's a great pleasure to come to the Korea Society. I know how much, you know, a lot of great work that you do in promoting Korea and Korean culture here at the Korea Society. I'm here to attend the General Assembly at the UN, where the Special Rapporteur, Mr. Daruzman, and also the Commission of Inquiry, COI, was giving its mid-report at the same time. So it's a very important session, the third committee of the General Assembly. And I gave, sort of representing the Republic of Korea, giving our piece of our thoughts on the issue, and also urging North Korea to be more proactive and more responsive to the calls of both the Special Rapporteur and the COI. So it was an interesting morning session, and I'm glad to be here now. Thank you.
Well, thank you. The Commission of Inquiry has done some fascinating work, and a lot of people in Seoul and around the world sat up and listened very intently about a month back when there were 10 days of testimonials about treatment by North Korean refugees from their experiences in the camps. Did you have thoughts relative to that and the impressions that that testimony has left on you?
Well, I mean, I think what's important to understand is that although it may not necessarily be something out of the blue that people absolutely didn't know about, we already know all the atrocities that goes on in North Korea. We know of the existence of the political prisons, the gulags, the torture, the all sorts of violation of human rights that goes on in North Korea. Now, what makes the COI so important is the fact that institutionally, the United Nations is keeping all these facts on data officially at the United Nations, and that has to be a great deal of source of pressure on North Korea. So if you're the, you know, if you're the culprit, if you're doing the, you know, involved in these tortures and at the United Nations, you hear about their names, because in attending those hearings while they were being held in Korea, the committee was very specific in asking about who was responsible. You know, what are their names? Exactly what did they do? So I think that's a very, very important factor. And if you're the one who's responsible and your name is floating around at the United Nations, that has to serve as a great deal of pressure, and maybe, hopefully, lead to them refraining from further actions as such.
Mm-hmm. And that documentation, it really does seem to play a critical role. We've seen that with Cambodia. We've seen that in the wake of the situation in the Balkans, certainly around Rwanda and other issues. When you look at the human rights situation, when you and I were back in our professorial days, most attention was placed on the denuclearization issue, the concern about North Korea's proliferation on both missile and nuclear weapons fronts. But it seems now that both nationally here in the United States and perhaps internationally, the concern about human rights has really elevated. What do you think about that awareness?
Yeah, and I think that's very, very important that there has to be an increase in the international awareness of what's going on in North Korea. Of course, that's not to take away from the importance of the nuclear issue. I mean, that remains a serious, serious concern for all of us. And you know, it is a huge challenge to the non-proliferation regime in the global context. But at the same time, the international human rights regime has also grown significantly in the past couple of decades. And if you look at the global situation, there's no place probably more urgent, or at least I would say that, you know, it deserves as much attention as anywhere else in terms of the blatant violations of all codes of human rights. I mean, whether it's the civil and political rights, whether it's the economic, social, cultural rights, you name it, North Korea is violating. And therefore, I think it's very, very important that there is an increase in the awareness of what's going on. And I think the establishment of the institutions such as the Special Rapporteur at the UN and the COI is a very, very important step furthering this effort, international effort, to increase the awareness. And I hope that that because the COI is a one-year term, you know, there's a lot of questions as to what's next beyond March next year. And we're hoping that there is a rollover or there's some further development where we can expect this to be taken to the next stage.
Mm-hmm. On the release of that report, we will be having a program here at the Korea Society. Frank Januzzi from Amnesty International will join us for that and help us to try to decipher some of that. Do you have any feelings about where things might go after that year period, or it depends on the nature of the report and the content of it?
I mean, those questions hovered in the earlier morning session at the General Assembly as well. We don't know for sure, but What I can say is that, and probably this is what the committee is saying, that the mandate is limited to the investigation. It's not to prosecute those responsible for the human rights violations. So they're sticking to that mandate of investigating as much as possible in looking into the human rights violations and also who's responsible for those violations. Now, if it's not to be rolled over into a further second or third years, I don't know. I mean, maybe a North Korean Human Rights Center could be established. We're hoping that it could be referred to the Security Council, but we may be a few steps. That may be a little too advanced to be expecting that. So I believe that there are many ways that that the investigations of the COI could be useful. But you know, what I would hate to see is just complete stoppage at the end of the report in March, and that's that. Then it's a year that may be considered to have been wasted if there's no further steps to it. So we're all very hopeful that that this could develop into something even bigger and more influential in dealing with the human rights violations.
Mm-hmm. Ambassador Lee, one of the things that has happened here in the United States, certainly in the last year or two, has been some shift in U.S. public thinking about North Korea human rights. We had the release of Blaine Harden's escape from Camp 14 on the day of its release here at the Korea Society. Shin Dong-hyuk, the subject of that book, was here with him at the time. He was also the first person to testify for the COI Commission in Seoul, and very graphic testimonial that I think moved a lot of people who heard it. We have had programs here on the effect of the transportation illegally of women from North Korea, the Underground Railroad. We have had some social science analysis on refugees and where they have wound up. And our film programs here have dealt with North Korean refugees and the resettlement process in Seoul and elsewhere. So we feel fairly active on it. We were happy to see that 60 Minutes picked up a piece with Anderson Cooper on the release of Escape from Camp 14. All of this has meant a growing awareness among American high school students and university students, as well as among the general public, about North Korea and its human rights violations. What have you seen in terms of South Korean public reaction? How do you feel South Koreans navigate the emotions and the attention on what's happening north of the DMZ?
Well, Likewise, in South Korea as well, and particularly amongst the younger population, so at universities and colleges, this issue is being picked up, the human rights issue. And of course, when it comes to human rights, I mean, we're mainly looking at North Korean human rights issue. And nobody's really pushing them into this. I mean, at some point earlier, particularly in the 90s and maybe into the 2000s, there were concerns that that in Korea, especially the younger generations, may be turning too radical, too leftist, and that maybe too maybe pro-North Korea, if you will. But that has hardly been the case. In fact, the younger generation, those people in colleges, are forming groups and clubs that deal with North Korean human rights violations, because for them, this is unacceptable. So they're becoming very global in their orientation. They're beginning to look into the universal values, such as human rights, and they're looking just across the border and seeing that this is happening in 2013, and it shouldn't be happening as such. I mean, this is, you know, when you consider all the luxuries and you know, the comforts of the living standard that we enjoy in South Korea, these are the same people, our compatriots, and yet a tremendous suffering going on. And a lot of the young kids are thinking that, you know, this is unacceptable and that we should be doing something about it. So it's a, you know, there's a very positive trend in looking at the issue, and youngsters are becoming proactive in stepping forward to say that, hey, we have to do something about this. So I would say that there's a very similar trend in that sense.
Mm, that's a very hopeful message. Thank you. I'd like to turn to some of our experts here and ask if they have any questions or comments for Ambassador Lee. We're very delighted to be joined by the distinguished analyst and scholar, David Hawk, who is the author of Hidden Gulag. And David, I wondered if you wanted to lead off with any thoughts or any questions directly for Ambassador Lee.
Thank you. You spoke very well this morning.
Oh, were you there?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I didn't see you.
And I'm glad to hear you mention now, I hope you're speaking for your government in hoping that the recommendations and findings of the Commission of Inquiry are forwarded to the Security Council. But you mentioned that that might be several steps away, and I wondered what those steps might be.
Oh, when I mentioned several steps away, I guess what I meant was the more the Security Council actually taking immediate action following the final report by the COI. So I'm a little bit skeptical that that the COI final report in March will lead to an immediate action taken by the Security Council in terms of actual, for example, prosecution of certain individuals responsible for the violations, as may be pointed out by the COI report. So that's what I meant. There may be some time lapse before we actually see the Security Council taking concrete actions following the report. That's what I meant. So maybe meanwhile, the ARIA, you know, sort of like procedure, it's not really official, but sort of like semi-official, you know, that sort of steps towards more formal action. But I think, you know, what I'm new to this myself, but from that short time period that I'm finding out more is that nothing really gets to be implemented right away at the UN. So, you know, it's a very, very procedural and you know, things have to be built up. I mean, you were there this morning. There's like very, you know, expected responses from countries like Cuba, Venezuela, China. So, I mean, this is, I guess, what the United Nations has to deal with. And I think the chairman of the committee, Mr. Kirby, did a, you know, very nice job in handling those criticisms of what they consider to be, partial and biased. So I think in that sense that that you are dealing, the United Nations is actually dealing with so many different countries and opinions, and at the Security Council, of course, you're dealing with China and Soviet Union, in particular China, and therefore, especially, and we heard this morning also, what the Chinese delegation was saying on the, particularly on the North Korean defectors, very adamantly saying that they're not refugees. And that China is has all the right to deal with them in accordance with their domestic law, which of course goes against the grains of the trend of what the international community understands. So that's basically what I meant, that it may be a while before the Security Council acts, and I hope it does, and that there may have to be several steps building towards that ultimate goal for the Security Council to act on this issue.
Of course, Korea sits on the Security Council right now in a rotating seat, having had the presidency in February, and will actually, because of the alphabet, have a second turn of the presidency before the end of its tenure. And so it's interesting to think ahead about the Korean agenda. Not that North Korean human rights are just a Korean concern, obviously. It's a concern for all of us. Mm-hmm. David, did you have any follow-up to that, or?
I have a different question.
Oh, please.
The UN, but how does South Korea's concern for the human rights situation in North Korea mesh with trust politique?
The balance of trust politique and human rights.
Trust politique or trust process. I think there's been a lot of questions asked on the our new government, Bakune government's trust process or trust building. What basically President Park means by this is to suggest that that we have to start from very very basic, that there is no trust. And therefore, without trust, what's the point of, say, Kumgang Mountain? I mean, that's just an example, doing several projects, cooperative projects or what have you. That will remain sort of eventful without basic trust. So you need the fundamental trust. And then with that trust, if you're able to, cultivate the Kaesong Industrial Park or Kumgang Mountain tourism or other inter-Korean cooperation, then it will mean something that you can build on those towards something larger. But without the trust, fundamental trust, these events or these developments in cooperation will remain very isolated and will not really lead to anything further. And that's been, where Korea's been at for the past, two decades or so. So she genuinely wants an improvement in inter-Korean relations, and she genuinely wants stability on the Korean Peninsula. And that, of course, has to include, when we're talking about stability and security, we're not just talking about security in terms of military security, really. I don't know if muzzling is a good word to use, but really coming to grips with the North Korean nuclear issue. But at the same time, we're talking about human security as well. So she's very concerned about the human security situation. She's been very open about wanting to provide humanitarian assistance. But all of these, she hopes to be tied to the greater goal. Eventually, I mean, she speaks very freely and openly about reunification as well, probably more so than any of the previous presidents. So this is a goal. I don't know if it's going to take place within her tenure, but I think, when she speaks of the reunification, and that has to be the ultimate solution to North Korean human rights issue, isn't it? So she sets that goal, whether it's within her tenure or whether it's, a bit long-term. But, whatever we do has to be in step. And, it's like a puzzle. towards that ultimate goal. Up to this point, and I'm not, you know, I don't mean to be critical of the previous governments, I don't think there was this like grand design or grand plan, ultimate goal towards the unification. I think it's just very ad hoc, you know, sort of spontaneous, responding to sort of the moods of North Korea. I think she wants to change that, to change the pattern of inter-Korean relations. And that's why she's been very adamant about when North Korea shut down the Kaesong Industrial Park. She was, you know, she put out certain principles that if those principles are not met, that the Kaesong would not be resumed. Despite North Korea's efforts to somehow tie the family reunion issue with the reopening of the Geunggang Mountain, she refused. So, you know, all of this suggests that, you know, she means business when she's talking about principles and fundamental trust. And she doesn't want to do anything without that fundamental trust being established. And hopefully, once those fundamental trust is established, she's hoping that the human rights issue could be dealt with in more earnestly.
Ambassador Mark Newton from the Experts Committee.
Thanks very much. The Commission of Inquiry has a very broad mandate, takes a very broad approach to the issue of human rights across the whole sweep of the issue. And that, in some ways, seems a forlorn hope that we're going to see early change across the board sweep, as I say, which is not, of course, to say we should give up. But I wondered if you think there's any other approach or niche where we might be able to see some progress with North Korea on human rights issues. Any sort of area where the international community, either through diplomacy or public diplomacy or any other means, could actually hope for some change in North Korean attitudes and actions?
Well, I mean, you're right. Yes, the COI's mandate is broad, and it is at the same time limited in what it does. But at the same time, I think it's a tremendous factor in not only putting the pressure on North Korea. I believe that, you know, all this that's going on, especially at the UN level, in the international community, has to be very uncomforting to China, I would think. China, of course, spoke its piece and didn't really give full endorsement, it seems, to what was being said. But at the same time, this North Korean human rights issue is becoming a bigger burden, I believe, on China that wants to play a bigger role in the international scene and continuing to be a patron of the state that so blatantly violates human rights. You know, it's just not looking good on China. So in that sense, I think, you know, I think it serves its purpose in a significant way. So, I mean, if you're asking if there's any other way, I would hope that somehow the UN, the international community will continue to grope for ways to persuade, I wouldn't say pressure, but persuade China to take a much more resolute stance on this issue. And how you go about doing that, you know, that's I think there are ways to do this, but that's a difficult question. But I think that's, you know, that's really the key to getting at North Korea rather than hoping that North Korea all of a sudden changes.
Mm-hmm. Ambassador, you'll be happy to know on December 13th, we're gathering experts here at the Korea Society to talk about the relationship among Korea, China, and the United States, especially in light of the Park Geun-hye Xi Jinping meeting, mm-hmm. following on the very successful summits that President Obama had with President Park, as well as his summit with President Xi. So taking a look 6 months after, and certainly the human rights question will be on our agenda for that morning, and we'll certainly keep you advised. This concludes the recording portion of it, and I did want an opportunity for you to talk with our group here just one-on-one. We also have some nice refreshments for you, but I appreciate your taking the time today to share some comments. We hope to have you back whenever you're in New York. Feel free, and please do consider the Korea Society home. Several of us here in the audience, that we can compare our Fletcher notes as well as Oxford and others. But you really are a person of great note, both in the academic sphere and now in the policy sphere. And we're delighted that President Park Geun-hye has named you for this very special position at a time when this issue really is at the fore of international thought. Thank you for being here at the Korea Society, Ambassador Lee.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you. And we did want to extend to you as well a special offer and friend extension.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. And really a special thanks from our Chairman, Ambassador Tom Hubbard, and our President, Ambassador Mark Mitten. Thank you.
Thank you.